the former Extempo monarch himself. He's here with us. Winston Gypsy Peters, welcome.
Good morning. Welcome. Thank you very much. Welcome. Thank you, Trinidad and Tobago and wherever else we heard.
Now, you know, first of all, did you see this defeat coming?
Well, anytime you go in a competition, there's only two outcomes you could have. You could either win or lose. And whenever you go in anything, you know, that should be expected. I'm not invincible.
Some would think you are.
Well, I don't think so. So if anybody thinks so, well, I mean, I might appreciate it, but I don't think so at all. I think that anybody could be beaten in anything at any given time. Losing as a champ don't mean that you're not good at what you do.
Exactly.
But like anything else, it happens. You could be the brightest person in the world and fail the simplest exam. You could be the fastest runner in the world, and for one reason or the other, you lose a race, or the best boxer, and you lose a bout. And that's life, you know. Life is made up that way. And more than anything else, I want to say something, and I want to commend Myron, even though he's not here and he was supposed to be. I don't know where he's at anyway. But one thing that I like, because you see, when we resuscitated this extempo thing, extempo is an art form, and calypso basically is a derivative of extempo, would you believe? And when it was as a dying art, and in the early 80s, when Mr. Dupini and Straker and a couple of these guys wanted to put it back together, which was good foresight, and they asked me. Nobody knew I could extempo, as a matter of fact, until I went up against Relator and that kind of thing. And then, you know, they decided to put it together and ask me to do it. And we put it together. It's not just something that we do because we want to be in a competition. It is something that we do because we want to keep an art form. It's like an archival work. It is something, it's like a historical building that we don't want to be demolished like we want to do in Trinidad and Tobago. Demolish everything that we deem to be old. We have little respect for old people. We don't like old buildings. This car is too old, you know, when everywhere else it's either an antique or historical building, or it's an historical art form. That is what extempo really is, a historical art form which we want to archive for a generation that would come long, long, long after us. And when people like Myron B. and others have excelled and continue to excel, people like my good self, I'm extremely happy. You know, it's not that I would go there and want them to beat me or go there and not do the best that I can.
Yes.
But if it is that they're doing it and they're doing it genuinely, I am extremely happy, because it means that my hard work is not going down the drain. Because it is, you know, I am virtually an extempo teacher, because I have given even Myron a lot of pointers. As a matter of fact, one time Myron came and he came on stage. I was so mad with him that I put him off. No, I'm serious, I did. And tell him, look, Nano, you have to go and correct this nonsense that you and these two people you're bringing here doing. Because this is not a papi show thing. Extempo is not a papi show thing as far as I am concerned. It's a serious thing. It is something that we want to keep for all times. And we want it to be, whatever we do, the material must be good. So that 50, 60 years from now, you know, when we are long gone, we would have the young people seeing what it is. Just like I saw Pretender and they, but they fell off the map because there was nothing to keep their interest. And this is what we don't want. I want something to keep their interest. And you know, Trinidad is a very competitive place, and hence the reason why we have competition the way it is in extempo, because you have to get something to keep the people's interest. And you can't go and negotiate with people to go and do extempo. Well, I negotiate with, when I go away, I tell them, like, for my night's work or whatever, I'll charge. But when you want to encourage young people, you have to have an incentive. And the incentive in this case is the prize money. And we are happy that it is that way.
Now, so this was just, it wasn't just a defeat for you, it was a proud moment, because
of
we were
course,
able to
of
see.
Of course, yeah. Of course. I am not at all, I haven't felt defeated in any way. As a matter of fact, I'm happy that Myron won.
So you feel accomplished that this was your student?
Yes, it is. And I would feel accomplished as long as they win fairly.
Right.
Because you don't want judges to just come and believe that you're winning too much. And because you're winning too much, they must give it to somebody else. Because that is not accomplishing anything. You must have an objective. You must have a target you know, that you must go after. And in this case, I have stayed away from Extempo for a while, you know, because there are times when I haven't been there for 5 years, mm-hmm. there are times when I haven't been there for 3 years and 2 years and what have you. But and every time I'm not there, I watch the standard drop, because they have nothing to really go at. All of them there at the same standard. I mean, there's nothing, you're not gonna accomplish anything by that.
So what made you come back?
Well, this is what I do. This Extempo is my job. I'm an entertainer by nature. I've been entertaining since I'm 4 years old. Mm-hmm. And you very well know that I'm involved in the politics of Trinidad and Tobago. And sometimes my other activities take me away from doing what I want to do. You know, well, I love all of them. I like politics, you know.
Really?
Because the world don't run without it. I mean, unlike what people think, I hear people in Trinidad and Tobago saying, this political thing and we mustn't do this. I want them to show me one country in the world that is run without politics. Just one, anyone. I want them to show me one religion up in heaven, based on what we know. None of us have ever been there. I don't know how they know all these things. But based on what you know about heaven, you have God, then you have Jesus, then you have, they say, Michael the Archangel, and you have all these other people. So in everything you have a hierarchy. Every single thing in the world is run by some hierarchy, starting with religion of any kind. So when people try to bring down politics and talk about this political thing and this one in politics and this one, politics should be, all of us should aspire to be in politics. You know why? Politics is what guides all of us life. As a matter of fact, politics dictates for us. Tomorrow morning, this government of Trinidad and Tobago right now could get up tomorrow morning and say none of us could come out of our house. They could get up and say that we can't do this. They could get up and say we can't go up this street or we can't drive down this street. It's only the government could do that. Nobody else can do it. So I am saying to you that that politics is not a bad thing, and we should aspire to get into politics if you have the acumen to do it. And I, fortunately enough, have it. Somehow or the other, I don't know how I acquired it, but I did. And it keeps me away from my extempo or from singing calypso or doing whatever sometimes, because I'm multifaceted. And that makes it a little...
All right, so I want to look at the art form as it is. Let's look at it with a magnifying glass.
Yes.
Now, there are some years, you said, for 5 years plus, you stayed away from this industry for particular reasons.
Yes.
We are national TV. We need to know what some of those reasons are so that we can possibly work towards making it better.
Well, a lot of the reason, one of the time when I stayed away, it was because I think that I had gotten into politics at a particular point in time. And I think that the bias judging, the judging became so skewed against me that I just thought that I shouldn't be. Let me give you one instant that I always remembered, and I use it as my yardstick. I was in a competition with a guy called Sheldon John, God rest his soul. He was one of the people who had improved in the extempo thing, and I'm happy a young man who came in. And we had to sing about Blue Boy, not even Blue Boy, about Austin Lyon, who in fact is Blue Boy and who became Super Blue. And he, in one of his verse, say, because he couldn't remember to say anything. He had no words. So I went on an extempo. And in the second verse, he said, Austin Lyon is a fire, because he have a daughter named Fayan. And at the end of the night, he won. And I find it was preposterous. I find it was ridiculous. I find it was outlawish. So I decided that, you see that? If this is what this is going to come to, then I'm going to recuse myself from doing it, which I did. And I stayed away for like 3 years because of that. And then it was getting so bad that they came and they asked me to come back in this thing. They said, Gypsy, you can't do that. I mean, come back in it. I said, but I'm not going to subject myself to nobody, because whether they judge me fairly or unfairly, that wouldn't stop me from being a good extemporaneous. So I don't need that in any way. So I just came back after being asked to do it, and I came again and win again, and I thought I lost again to Big B, which was genuinely lose. I lost. Right. Big B beat me. Black Sage won me before. Yeah. Lingo won before. Yeah. And I have nothing against that. So I'm saying to you, and then the politics became so intense that I got into it in a way now, and I became the representative and a government minister. Yeah. Which I was for just about 5 years. And that kept me away from active actively taking part. It didn't mean that I did next temple from time to time. And that's the next stupidness in this country. Mm-hmm. You are a culture minister of Trinidad and Tobago, and that's why I would harken back to Mr. Pandey. When I got into politics, I was a very active Calypsonian as well, and I still had contractual obligations all over the place. And Mr. Pandey said, listen, you are the culture minister. I was a junior minister at the time, and he said, what is the best person to go and represent a country or to sing anywhere, the culture minister, if you had the ability to do it? What's the problem? But in Trinidad and Tobago, we are so British-oriented and so colonialized that we can't even extricate ourselves from the nonsense. That if you are a minister and you're a fellow who used to be a racing car driver, you mustn't go back and race at all. If you're you become a minister, you can't go on and run if you was a runner. If you're a singer, you mustn't go and sing because you're a minister of government. Now, what absurdity. And I find it is so foolish, and I must thank Mr. Pandey for that. And also Kamala Prasad Bisesa, my then prime minister, because she told me to go and sing my calypso if I want to. But I didn't go and take part in the competition and thing, because right. You cannot be the arbiter and the offender at the same time.
Yeah.
So I was self-regulating, and I didn't go and take part in it. But nothing should stop you from taking part in it if you want to. I'm not the only Calypsonian in the world who is involved in politics. In Antigua, a former government minister was a Calypsonian. In Guyana, we have a lot of that all over the place. And they are allowed to go and take part in their thing, and I find we should as well. Keep on doing what you're doing, as long as there are some professions that doesn't lend itself to doing that. Take for instance, if you're a gynecologist and you become minister of whatever, that could create a lot of problems for you. But if you're a singer, then why not go and sing? If you're a runner, why not continue running? So,
all right. So we look at Myron B, and you're very proud of the fact.
I'm proud of him.
We see, okay, fine, Extempo is headed in the right direction
yeah.
When it comes to the youth and participation.
Yes.
But let's look at the other part of it, mm-hmm. in terms of the support, even financially.
Mm-hmm.
Is it really receiving the kind of support that it should?
Well, I really don't know what kind of support they need, because this art form has been existing for years without that kind of governmental support. And I think in a lot of ways the governmental support has governed on a lot of things that we are supposed to be doing on our own, and we have become too dependent on the coffers of the government, of the treasury. We have become too dependent on a lot of things. So it's like your brain, if you don't use it all the time to do what you're supposed to do, it becomes lazy. And the things, I bet a lot of us can't remember a lot of phone numbers now.
Good point.
Including me. Because the fact remains is that the numbers that you used to remember so well, they're all stored in some kind of phone that you have there now. So you don't even take time to do it. And that is what happened to us. Our mindset now is that we must depend on the government for subvention. Everything, the word subvention and the word, well, in Trinidad and Tobago, gimme, gimme.
Mm-hmm.
It has become, synonymous with all the things that we have to do that is cultural and otherwise. People want a house, the government must give them. People want some job for somebody, the government must get it for you. You have a drain in the back of your house, in your house that you build without any permission at all, but the government must fix that for you. Every single thing, we have become dependent on the government. I don't know where we're going to get rid of that mindset, but the entertainment and the cultural sphere is no different to that. We have inculcated that within our own ambit, and that is what is happening to us today, that every aspect of our cultural, the way we pan people want you to give them everything, Calypsonian, they want you to give them everything, and that shouldn't be. We must find ways to be independent of the government. Yes, the government has an obligation to do certain things, because government are indeed facilitators, but that facilitation stops at a certain point. It cannot be that it's indefinite, and you've got to give people everything. So, and that's why we in this kind of headache that we're in today, because we have given so much, we have given what we ain't have and all.
All right. I want to talk a little bit about the topics that were selected mm-hmm. on the night. There was one particular participant who wasn't particularly pleased about the topic he got.
I know. That's
Bury Me Upside Down.
Yeah, that's London, Brian.
Yeah. What are your thoughts on the topics?
Well, my thoughts are, yes, they do have stupid topics, but at the end of the day, you have to find some way to deal with it, whether you deal with it humorously, seriously, you know, or otherwise. But you have to find some way. I got topics that I knew nothing about already. I remember one time I got a topic about Kardashian, some kind of Kardashian people.
And you knew?
I didn't know nothing about them. I mean, I knew about it after, but I knew nothing about what was going on there with some short marriage or something.
So how but, were you able to wing that?
Well, because you wing it by saying you don't know about it, and whoever these Kardashian people is, to hell with them. That is exactly how you do it. You don't go about and just, I say, but I don't know who these Kardashian or whoever they are. Whoever them are, that is them business. I want to talk about. And you find something in Trinidad to associate that same kind of thing that you don't know about with. And
that's
you do
skill.
It. But that is where the skill come in. It's like an architect. They give you a piece of land, and all they give you is the land, and say, well, this land is rectangular, this land is triangular, this land is whatever it is, and you have to design something to put there that would fit there, that would be both aesthetically appealing and at the same time purposefully built. And you have to learn to do that, and that's what I think in terms of my extempoing skill I do. One of the acumen that you must have as an extempo singer, which is one I think that I like, I like to read.
There you go. That was my next question. How do you sharpen that skill?
Well, I like to read. I mean, I have read every comic book that they have in the world when I was a child, because we didn't have no television and we didn't have no all these distractions. So our thing was comic book. I think I learned to read from the comic books. And I read every comic books, and that remained in me today. So I still like to read everything. I like to read, so I read and read and read and read. So I just know I could actually sit down with almost anybody and discuss any topic, whether it's national, international, regional, or otherwise, because I have done that to myself.
But it's a skill. It's something as well. It has to be kind of natural as well.
Well, it's
right?
Like anything. Like if you're a builder, all they will give you a building material. You know, you have to learn to put it together. And when you have acquired a good vocabulary, that's the building material. But when you have to build something with that vocabulary, you are the one who have to design it, and you are the one who have to learn how to do it. And that is what we do. And today, it apart from the extempo thing. Mm-hmm. We don't have a lot of young singers who write for themselves.
Old songs, yeah, that's
they don't write for themselves because they don't have the building material to do it. And I try to, when I talk to them or anything, encourage them to get that material to build it, because all you are doing when you get on stage there, right, is really and truly, you know, expressing somebody else's feeling. Mm-hmm. That you are trying to do, but sometimes you don't even want to say that thing that they give you there, you know. You feel to say something else, but you're feeling it within you, but to express it is a different thing because you don't know how.
The connection.
Because you don't have the wherewithal to do it.
Now, another thing, your style is that, okay, they are telling me that I don't have time. I really want to squeeze this question in.
Please.
What you do when you walk on stage and you're about to perform, the band starts playing before. It's quick thinking.
Well, I allow the band to play before because I want people to know that it is not something. Because a lot of people, like one lady called and said to me, you know, we know that there's give all a whole lot of topics 2 or 3 months before. And then that night when you go there. So when I do that, I don't know what they're going to do. Yeah. But I allow the band to start so that people wouldn't think. Because it's a show you're doing at the end of the day, you know. And you must put some interest into it for the people who pay to come and see you. So there are things that you would have to do. So that is my way of doing it. I do that to let the band play, and then I get my topic, so I go right into it, so they know that is not a gimmickry.
All right, so let the band play. I'd like to ask you to close the segment as we go for a break.
I want to tell you that it was so fair. This morning I was so glad that I am here. I telling you, my dear, I want you to know it's a pleasure that I was here on your show. But where is my run? I cannot see. Look like my run hiding for me. So next time, my dear, we are on your show. I hope Myron B would be here also. Okay.
Thank you so much. We take a short break. Coming to you with more.